Well, I want to welcome you to our program today. We have a very special guest. Her name is Liz Goodfellow. And so, Liz, thank you so much for coming on the program today.
Thank you.
Liz is from Indianapolis, Indiana. She works for the University of Indiana and also the University of Purdue. And but she's on the program today because she has written a couple of very special children's books that have an angel theme. And so, well, anyway, Indiana, those are two big universities, University of Indiana and then also...
Indiana University.
Indiana University and Purdue.
Yes.
Yeah, I know how they are always playing the Hawkeyes and the Badgers
yes.
and stuff. And yeah, so what is your position there?
I am the major gifts officer for the School of Liberal Arts at IUPUI, or Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis.
And how long have you been in that position?
For almost 2 years.
Almost 2 years, yeah. And so that is quite a background that you have. And so, but obviously you've got creativity in that you have been writing books, children's books. And so what got you inspired to write children's books?
Actually, when I lived here in Dubuque, I was taking a writing class under John Tigas, who we would meet once a week, and I would be producing something once a week. And after I finished this main novel that I was working on, I needed to do something different. And also at the same time, there was a writing contest coming up. And so I thought, what could I write about that would fit this kind of contest? It was a short story fictional contest. And I have always been fascinated by angels. I think they're very active in our lives, and people don't always understand that. And of course, we don't typically see angels, or that we know of, because they don't always take on the form that they do in these little angel stories. So I was inspired then to write about little angels. I've always enjoyed children as well, and so I kind of wanted to make them little angels instead of the angels we typically think of. And I actually entered this into that contest and it won.
So
Exasperation was a first place winner. So that was fun.
Yeah, so having a fascination with angels, which I think most people have, you know, some kind of a sentimental feeling or the sense that angels are among us, people of faith, that angels are with us to guide us, to protect us, to inspire us, share messages. Well, that's Gabriel would be a messenger of God. You know, that's literally what his name means, but that's what angels do as we think about it. But you know, but angels certainly do open up a whole fantasy, a whole creativity in our minds when we try to picture angels, what are angels doing. I think we can fall in love with, of course, the Christmas story as the angels are flooding the skies and praising the Lord. And so the angel, I can see where this book, and I've read these, and you really connect with them, and I can see where you have a lot of fun for parents to read these to their children, or their grandparents reading them to the grandchildren. But you know, just these really have kind of an exciting, humorous story to them. And and as I was reading them, it's like, okay, how's this all going to end? And then you have really, you know, quite a special ending to them. Yeah, so that's where you started writing, and you chose an angel theme. And so it's kind of, so this first one, this is the one that won the contest, Exasperation, and I noticed that it's spelled E-G-G hyphen aspiration. And so why don't we just talk about that a little bit as far as, and this was your second book.
Yes.
Your first book is Angels Unaware. But okay, well, this is your second book, Exasperation. And so obviously we see that there are angels in the in this book,
mm-hmm.
and they got their halos over their heads. and so there's the story where, well, why don't you share a little bit about the story of how, you know, Exasperation, just the title of it. I think that's so interesting and how that feeds into the story. Yeah.
Well, I did pick the egg or the spelling of it because it is about eggs. And Sparky tends to flub his landings. He's just always struggled with that. Do you mind?
Yeah.
So he crash lands again. The story starts out with Gabby, though, she's polishing her halo and rearranges it over her head. When I'm reading this to children, I first talk to them, do they know about angels? And typically they have some concept of that and often tell me they fly. And so I can add that Sparky has trouble flying. But I also try to put lessons in these stories where Gabby is proud of her work at the crisis intervention headquarters where she's answering calls and sending angels on emergency assignments. I also mentioned to the kids what some of these emergency assignments might be. Maybe a dog stuck in a mud or a cat stuck in a tree or a boy has fallen off his bike or something. So they get this concept of angels being around them to help them as well. But she feels proud of what she's doing, so I'll ask the children how they feel when a parent or a teacher or somebody says, you did a great job today. And they often raise their hands to tell me, you know, how good they felt in that. And so I relate that to Gabby as well. But then she finds Sparky hiding behind the filing cabinet. And I oftentimes think about how we have people in our lives who have disabilities, and sometimes disabilities that we can't see. And oftentimes they do hide behind a proverbial filing cabinet or someplace because they don't want to see that they've flubbed up or they did something wrong. But Gabby, being the friend, says, you know, Sparky, what happened? You know, how can we help? So the story goes on. He tried to fix the problem himself, which oftentimes kids will find some creative way to do that. So where he tore his wing in his landing, he ends up going down to a chicken coop to find feathers to patch his own wings. And from there, eggs appear in his pockets. So now they have quite a task of trying to figure out how are they going to stop these eggs. Everything from getting a new robe at Heavenly Hills Mall or Gracie's department store to going to the cleaners and trying to fix the situation by steaming the feathers. But in the end, those things don't work. But through that, Archangel Michael sees that this is an opportunity to use these eggs as a symbol of the resurrection and new life. And chicks, of course, popped out of them as well. And they are a symbol of new life too. And so in the end, Sparky's wings are fixed through the touch of Archangel Michael or God's healing powers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so integrating, you know, a lot of themes, you know, like children and sometimes, you know, the struggles and what they deal with in a way that is very creative and fun when we think about mm-hmm. angels and their mm-hmm. wings and their halos. But then, you know, seeing the positive that comes out of this, you know, how God works in our lives,
mm-hmm.
and the importance of praise and encouragement.
Right.
But then the Easter eggs and what a symbol that has, you know, that is of, well, the eggs in Easter. And, mm-hmm. and I noticed how beautifully these eggs are decorated. And so I know that that's something that children have so much fun doing every Easter time is decorating eggs
and
then going out and looking for eggs. So it's got all these beautiful themes that, that children, but then all of us, because we've all been children, that we can identify with. It does bring a happy feeling to us as we read this, but it does have a fun story to it. And so I would, you know, certainly encourage people. Now, where can people get the book?
They can get it on Amazon.com.
Yeah, go to Amazon.com.
Or through my website.
And here again, Liz Goodfellow, our guest, is one who has authored or written the book, but then also beautiful illustrations. And I see here you have Emmanuel Espiritu. Is that how you pronounce it?
As far as I know.
That's just cool. Okay. Illustrated this book, did a fantastic job. But I kind of noticed as I read through the book that, I noticed that Archangel Michael has got kind of a certain impressive look to him. It's almost like he almost has like a pharaoh or a kingly look to him.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Right. I think in my mind, I've not met an archangel yet that I know of. But in my mind, an archangel is more majestic, magnificent. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to have him portrayed that way.
More of like an authority. You know, the archangel is the lead angel. So mm-hmm. he looks like a person of wisdom and mm-hmm. might, mm-hmm. you know, somebody who, but it also looks like he's very loving and tender.
Right.
Yeah, very approachable. Mm-hmm. And then another thing that I noticed that I can really appreciate here, and that is so many of the figures are, you got quite a cultural diversity there mm-hmm. as far as races and
yes. Yeah, I especially wanted that when I was working with the illustrator. I said, you know, the two main characters are white, so I wanted to make sure the other angels, little angels, were of different ethnicity. Mm-hmm. It was kind of cute because I hadn't thought about an illustrator from the Philippines now living in the United Arab Emirates. What his definition of multicultural might be. So we were actually worked on the cover first, and when it came back, I said, I don't understand why some are still white. And he said, oh no, they're from Egypt. And you know, and we in America wouldn't typically think of multicultural people from Egypt. But so I think it broadens, or it certainly broadened my understanding of multicultural.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's so very important, and you know, today to make sure that everybody is feeling included and integrating mm-hmm. all of that. And you know, but the pictures are very beautiful, and I still remember when my mother would read me a little children's book, and some of those children books are ones that I would read over and over, and sometimes I would just be focused in on a page, because just in a page there's just so many interesting things, you know, that I could, you know, that you can explore and discover. And this book is like that, for little children to be able to, you know, focus in on, you know, all the little details, and you know, that children are very curious and they're fascinated by things like this. So between the story and the illustrations and the various themes, you know, that children can all connect with that, and also this is a good way for parents to be bonding with their children, as well as grandparents with their grandparents, to read a book like this. And so I just want to commend you and to say what a great job that you have done writing this book. And well, then you have another one.
I do have to point out this, when you talked about a favorite page, this is my oldest grandson's favorite page.
Oh, okay.
Because he just liked that idea of vacuuming up these fumes and holding this. Mm-hmm.
This is actually the first book that you wrote. Now, here
again,
this is Liz Goodfellow, and she is an author. She has published a couple of really cute children's books. And so we just got done talking about exasperation, but this was your first book, and this one is entitled Angels Unaware. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think it's in Hebrews chapter 13 that always be ready because you may be entertaining angels unaware. But I'll tell you what, these angels are actually very entertaining as you read them. They will make you laugh, they'll make you think, and you warm up to these angels. And so okay, let's talk about this book a little bit, Angels Unaware. And this was your first book. And so why don't you just share a little bit about, you know, what are the angels doing in this book? You know, what's kind of the main theme here?
Well, Gabby starts out again, and she is disappointed because she's not on any assignment list. And so she again feels like, oh, here I have this wonderful gift of gab, and it's not being put to good use. But in the end, well, I shouldn't say in the end, in the beginning, Sparky comes in, another crash landing. As you can see, Gabby's having to pick herself up. But they are called to Archangel Michael's office and then given an assignment. But again, she's disappointed because what he tends to give her or gives them is to go clean up fumes or this experiment that Einsteinia had been working on and was called off to another part of heaven on an emergency. So they do it anyway, being good little angels, and Sparky, of course, likes that opportunity. In the end, what happens is they cause this explosion that, again, they're thinking, oh no, we're going to be in trouble. They're never going to earn their gold wings. And so they try to hide this explosion by pushing it under the clouds of heaven and across the sky. And in the end, it is the Star of David that shines, that led the shepherds to the nativity to baby Jesus.
You sure have a depth of creativity to come up with, you know, these kinds of ideas. And so your first book here then really kind of brings us to Christmas. And I think, oh, Christmas and angels, and, you know, to hear the angels sing as, you know, as the shepherds are gathered in Bethlehem, and they hear the angels sing, you know, the heavenly chorus, and then of course the star that guides them, and so I can see where kids are really gonna enjoy reading this. Okay, well, this was your first book, and you had shared a little bit that you had taken a writing class, but when did you first kind of get an interest in writing? You know, obviously this is something that God has inspired you to do, that in your faith life, I don't know, as a child, did you first start kind of getting this creativity to want to write, you know, something, or where along the line did this come about to say, you know, I just enjoy writing?
Well, I actually won a contest in the sixth grade, which I look back now and think that's quite fascinating. But I had been doing grant writing for quite some time, and so people would ask me, would I help them with this, would I help with that? I also was helping my husband, who was writing an inspirational column for two newspapers. And then he was getting so busy, so I just picked it up and continued writing it. But what I would use, because my children were small at the time, and they're, to me, there are things all around us that happen that we often miss, or we don't see because we're either so busy or we're just not looking for things. And so in that week, I would be looking for those things. And oftentimes there are, of course, many, many things, but I usually would find something humorous that one of my children would say or do or be, and it was just kind of funny. And then I would add that little inspiration at the end of that, you know, kind of what lesson did we learn? And actually I'm working on, as I do these children's stories, I'm working on an adult book that I don't know if it'll be titled Things We Learn from Children, but it'll have that kind of piece of, you know, things they say or show us or do that are either heartwarming or funny or inspirational. So that got me started with really writing along this theme, and then it just kept growing.
Yeah, so the theme of the angels, So when did you first, like, for instance, write this first story? I mean, how,
I would say it was 1995.
So 1995, you got some inspiration to write this very cute story, and so that's kind of been in your mind, and then you wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
But then, is this one of those things where it got kind of put on the corner of the desk or in a file, thinking, well, and then you kind of go back to it? I mean, to where you finally felt like, well, I'm going to see about getting this illustrated and published.
Uh-huh. I actually, at the time, because I was in this class, and I tend to want to get my money's worth out of things, I was writing the story like once a week, so I have over 20 of these little angel stories. But because I always had another job to do, you're right, it kind of gets pushed aside and there it sits. And I had always felt like these are stories that I think others would enjoy. And I actually had 9 of them published way back then in the Julian's Journal here. And the TH published the winner of the Exasperation story.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew there was some audience for that and just really wanted to eventually put them into children's books. And almost gave up on that dream because I know children's books authors and they said it's so hard to break into that market. And then somebody said, why don't you look into self-publishing? And so that's what I did then. Mm-hmm. And it's been a lot of fun. And actually in some ways, I don't break even on these yet anyway, but I probably make more money than the others that go the other way with their stories as they tell mm-hmm. them. So unless they're really large authors.
Well, I'd say, you know, taking a class, and as you're in that class, you know, you are able to open up your creativity.
Mm-hmm.
You have some guidance from, you know, a professional teacher writer,
mm-hmm.
and so that's always helpful to kind of give you some pointers along the way, I would think.
Mm-hmm.
But it sounds like you were disciplined in that you, because I know how inspiration is sometimes, you can sit there and nothing comes, and then just like that you can be just flooded with it.
Oh.
But yet you were able to somehow, or with this, that at least when you go to class with all these ideas, that you were able to write a story each time.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think some of that helped because the main characters were the same, and I have other little angel characters with names as well. They don't mm-hmm. come into play with these books, but they will later. So I didn't have to reinvent that environment. Now, heaven in my mind kept growing for me because I could see, like in the first book, there's a glitter dispenser there, you know, and so that's kind of my cute little part of heaven. But there's, you know, different things that I then see in heaven as it expands. So I have to share that sometimes with the illustrator as we wrestle with what the background should be for different pages in the books.
Yeah. Well, you have your two main characters,
mm-hmm.
and so you have the story of what they are doing in this particular book, but you have now written 20.
Mm-hmm.
And so the first one, book that Liz has published is Angels Unaware. Here again, these are books with an angel theme, and this one really ties in with Christmas. And then the second one is Exasperation, and then with this angel, with the same characters, ends up having a Easter theme at the end. Okay, so these are two wonderful stories and two, you know, just very creative, beautiful books. I would encourage you to go out and to buy them and, you know, buy them for your grandchildren or buy them to read to your grandchildren or your children.
Excuse me, they are at River Lights Bookstore here too, and Paper Moon up in McGregor.
Paper Moon up in McGregor and River Lights Bookstore here mm-hmm. are in Dubuque. Yeah, so you have these books that could go into children's libraries and into church children libraries. Okay, so you got, so now is the hope to get the other 18 stories at this point published? Is that, are you going to keep going
with it? I do hope so. The next one should be out in June. If I go with the one I think I'm going, my husband's trying to get me to do the rainbow one, and I'm trying to do the northern lice one. So we'll see. We'll see. But I tend to tie in a little bit of history with the stories, again, to make people think about how God and angels are active in our lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a reality. It's these are, you kind of bring in your fantasy and your fiction, mm-hmm. but yet angels are real.
Mm-hmm.
And the issues that you bring out as far as what children deal with are real.
Mm-hmm.
In that God working in our lives. I mean, Christmas is real. Easter is real. Okay, so, well, I encourage you to continue on. I really
Thank
do.
You. Thank
yeah,
you.
I'd like to see a whole series of 20 of these children books. But I'm guessing that this will probably just continue on. I can almost see where this could be a weekly animated cartoon series ones that churches could get, you know, kind of like the VeggieTales kind of a thing.
Right.
Where Sunday school teachers or as we work with the little kids that mm-hmm. you could almost see having this all become animated into cartoons mm-hmm. Where you'd have, you know, quite a series of them. Yeah, so I think you're really onto something here and great inspiration, and here again, this brought out the little child in me as I was reading them, and it brought a smile to my face and a good feeling. And I must say, there's times where I was kind of laughing and also kind of just wondering how is this all going to end? And it's just like, wow, what an ending to that! That was really neat. How you just kind of, you know, kind of has its twists and turns. Well, this is Liz Goodfellow. You know, author of beautiful children's books, and I just want to thank you for coming on our program today, sharing your inspiration and your work with us. And so I just say God be with you, and you know, I encourage you to continue on. And for all of you, I want to thank you for joining us this day as well.